have a little bit of fun.
There we go. You know, it's a fun time. It's 100 episodes. You know, people are going to be like, what the hell?
It is. This blew my mind about 3 weeks ago when I'm like, wait, 100 episodes? Are you kidding me right now? That's insane. Well,
imagine being me and Henry, and we've already been down this road once before.
Yeah. Well, it's the 100th episode for the second time.
Well, listen.
I saw you an internet stalker the other day. How was that going?
Well, it really well.
Henry, you there, buddy?
Hey, Henry. We kind of see you. Well, I definitely see you.
He moved.
And she was, it was a movement.
Give me a wave. Give me a wave.
You were entertaining and all kinds of stuff. I was like, we're going to get you that fourth.
What was this? I missed this. What happened?
The girl that kept commenting on Henry's stuff going, oh, you're really interesting.
Guys, we are aiming.
I missed this. Okay.
It's a pre-show. Henry,
you know, get what you want before she gets the green card.
Wow.
Oh, man.
Okay. Wow. And you hit live. You did that. Oh, geez. Oh, holy cow. Boom, 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 boom. Anyway, hope all our friends that are jumping in live that are in West Virginia, I hope you're able to watch our show and seek shelter at the time.
Mm-hmm. Be safe. And, buckle down. Listen for warnings, folks.
Right.
Listen to warnings.
Siren isn't just annoying. It's telling you to, you know, stop.
Seek lower. Sean, left.
I don't know if you're aware, but we are streaming.
Yep. That's on purpose.
Yeah, that was the whole point.
We give the people a little extra tonight.
We give you the extra.
Oh, okay. I was about to say.
The extra quarter inch.
Oh, well. Hey,
whatever works for you there, buddy. You know?
That's all I've got to offer is the extra quarter inch.
Hey, you know what? You're an honest man, Vance. Folks, can always say that about me. He's an honest man. Yes. Abe Lincoln, George Washington, Vance Nesbitt. Yes.
Well, no, why not? What's the point? I don't want to go to jail for anything.
Well, hey, listen.
That's why you get ID first.
Photocopy it.
I do have that. I will provide that for future reference.
That's we'll keep you legal for less here at the Sasquatch Experience, folks. Mm-hmm. Free legal advice.
Mm-hmm. Just don't hold us accountable for that legal advice.
Matters of the heart.
Yeah,
do you guys remember the guy on the Tonight Show with David Letterman, Larry Bud Melman?
Oh yeah. Right.
And he'd always had that little spiel with before he started this, you know, for matters of the heart, personal matters, financial matters.
Right.
I love that. We should have a Larry Bud Melman.
We should. And OJ Simpson. Oh wait, he's dead. I'm sorry. Oh.
Did you say?
Baker, was it you that made the joke about now Johnny Cochran can get him out of this jam again or something? Yeah. That was funny.
Any chance he could go to hell, Johnny Cochran's up there. He can fix that right up.
You know what's crazy about that whole thing? Every single person on OJ's defense is dead of cancer.
Mm-hmm.
The prosecution, oh, no, they're all fine. Mm-hmm. But every single person has died of cancer the prosecution.
Are they fine, though? Because it seems like because they lost, most of them don't have jobs. You know, like you never heard of them again. You know, like.
Didn't Marcia Clark have to do Penthouse or Playboy or something?
Oh, well, maybe she did, and I wouldn't have seen it, so.
I wouldn't have either. It was that hair. That.
Speaking of beavers, there's a new dam in our neighborhood.
That's not what I meant by hair. I meant. Anyhow,
it wasn't a death.
This is the
5 minutes people usually don't get.
This is the stuff they don't get. But we thought we'd provide it tonight.
Yeah, and this is what you get. And this
hey,
is
but
what
you know
get.
What?
We are
in
so
all
sorry.
Fairness. It is time. To get it started, so let's kick this pig.
Really?
The views and opinions expressed by the guests of Sasquatch Experience do not necessarily reflect the opinion of the hosts, sponsors, or affiliates of the Sasquatch Experience. As always, listener discretion is advised.
911, what are you reporting?
We got someone or something crawling around out here.
Does a legend walk among us, lurking in the forests of our world?
Did you see what it was? Was it a person or an animal or?
I can't tell. All I know is that my central light came on and I just happened to glimpse and see this thing running across the yard. A good-sized man or something. It looks like a man. I don't know what it was.
For over 15 years, we've talked with scientists, researchers, investigators, and witnesses, trying to gain insight and proof around the existence of this mysterious entity.
Jesus Christ, you better... Tia!
Hello?
Get somebody out here.
What's going on now, sir?
That son of a bitch is about 6'9", I don't know.
Do you see him now, sir?
Yes, I'm looking right at him.
Okay, hang on.
He's right...
Is he in your yard, sir?
Yeah, God, he's big.
Okay, what's he doing in your yard?
He's looking at me.
Join us as we continue into the investigation of the Sasquatch Experience.
You know, my favorite part of that is the with Henry May.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know why. I love that a lot.
I thought you said back. Wit.
Wit. With
that's
onions.
Just mean.
Whiz wit.
Wit whiz.
Henry May. Wit whiz. That's right. Yeah. The only way to order it. In
Miracle Whip with Henry May. Yeah.
Oh, God. Miracle Whip. Die, Vance. Would you? Miracle Whip. Folks, Major. I'm Sean the Fork Chop Forker. That's Matt Arner. James Baker, Henry May, and Vance Nesbitt down in the corner where he rightfully belongs tonight. And here we are. Episode 100, The Legend Continues.
Woo!
That's right. You have all been with us once again for 100 episodes. God knows why, but we're glad you have stayed and have joined us as we've taken you through these mini explorations, expeditions into this wonderful topic we call Sasquatch. And you know, one of the things I'm proud about us guys in these 100 episodes is that it always seems like we bring new people to the table. You know, mm-hmm. we're bringing new people in to the conversation around something maybe they didn't care about a year ago. Maybe they, you know, who really knows why people get involved in this to begin with. But we're glad they are. And I'm just happy that we have a nice audience that seems to be enjoying it and coming along. But folks, we need you to do something important for us if you have not already. We need you to go to Apple Podcasts. We need you to go to Spotify. We need you to go to YouTube. Like, subscribe, comment, and tell us how we're doing. Definitely trying to build those customer satisfaction surveys, whatever we're calling them.
Mm-hmm.
And we will
ratings
satisfy.
And reviews. We will. Oh. Yeah, Baker. Oh. Baker is in charge of your satisfaction, folks. So you're just putting it out there.
Yeah, I'm going to step away right now.
Yeah. Boy, that's going to put the asses in the seats. Let me tell you. We got Les, our good man Les Sinkovich there. Hey boys. Hey Les, how you doing? Jay Charlotte, thanks for coming along again. Thank you. Congrats on 100. We appreciate that, dearly. Cryptic Crystal. Hand wave there. Nice avatar there, Cryptic. Mm-hmm.
I like that. That. Yep.
Hello
back at you and welcome. If this is your first time, let us know. We're glad to be the one bringing you in on the first time. We'll take it gentle. Don't worry. We'll be nice and considerate. Guys, this is a free-for-all show tonight. I didn't plan any topics because I really wanted us. This is 100 episodes. This is about us. And this is about how we've taken this show and kind of turned it into something a little different. One of the things I loved from a comment today that I read on Apple or podcast was appreciates the discussion around the science, but they're funny too. And we like that. We try to bring a little humor because you know you need humor in this field.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't have any, then you're a self-righteous idiot, and you're taking yourself too seriously.
Very true. All right. And with the rat shit that the world is going through right now, and excuse the language, but we need this. We definitely need this as our great distraction. So.
Well, you know, and it's funny, and Henry, I'll throw it over to you in just a moment, but we relaunched the show during COVID.
Mm-hmm.
Because we needed the distraction. The world was going to hell in a handbasket. All we had was each other, and we were all getting together virtually anyhow. So we thought, why not put it back together and do something a little positive with our quarantine time? And alas, this is what we had. And then we've been coming back strong. I mean, we had a little break after that, but I really feel like this incarnation, and we go back to 2005, 2006, you know, this has been the strongest, most stable version of the Sasquatch experience in a long time.
Yes, it has been. And it's Sean, like, and I, of course, we've been the two main proponents of the show. We were the guys who started it back in 2005 on Yahoo Messenger, of all things.
Yes.
So, and then we decided, Since this new medium of blog talk radio came along, we said, we're going to jump on that. We're going to start a show. So we did.
Yeah.
And we stole the theme from Unsolved Mysteries. And
we. Henry, back in 2005, wasn't your hair like halfway down your back at that point? And you, with your mullet?
Yeah, I wish. I wish.
I distinctly remember it being a little bit more red and a little bit more of it. Brown,
reddish brown, cinnamon colored. Yeah, mm-hmm.
And I think between the two of us, Henry and I were about 200 pounds lighter then too. So I mean, we're not throwing shade. We're just saying children. We've aged a little bit,
children.
We've aged. I was 17 when we launched Sasquatch Experience.
That's insane.
Yeah,
that's crazy. And you're still doing this. Older. When are you going to grow up? Come on.
I don't ever want to grow up. This is my
hobby. No, we hope you don't.
This is fun.
And I hope I don't either.
I mean, Henry, we've, you know, before we went on the air and before we, you know, Henry and I were talking, like, we've talked the gambit. We were in the middle of the Georgia Bigfoot hoax. We were knee deep in bullshit and Bigfoot, and we had people with corn fritter toes coming after us, and a man named Eric Beckyard who wouldn't leave me alone. First person to ever get him to hang up. Right here.
There you go.
I still win because he's dead and I'm alive.
We sweltered that whole day.
Right. So, I mean, when you go back and talk about the history of Sasquatch Experience and the things we've talked about, it's not always been the highest ranked show in terms of audio quality. We used to do it on our telephones and dial in. But I think one of the things that Sasquatch Experience has that none of the other shows do is heart.
Right.
Mm-hmm. I don't know if anybody loves this topic more than Henry May.
Right.
I really don't. And I don't know if anybody's had a tenacity for it like we've had and have managed to stay relevant for so long after all those years.
But then again, who is the official sponsor of Monster Fest?
Yes.
Small Town Monster.
That's us.
Represent. Yeah. That's us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And guys, if you missed last year's Small Town Monster Fest, we did a live show. It was a remarkable show led by this gentleman over here in the corner, James Baker. I think he
had a good audience.
Situation, didn't he, Matt?
Oh my God, it was incredible. Yes. I mean, you know, just his wit. Where, you know, people would come up with different questions, and he was able to formulate a perfect analogy that anyone can understand. And I'll tell you what, we were shocked. I mean, it was incredible. it was the Aralon Baker show. It was fantastic. Except for Santa Claus.
Yeah.
Oh no,
yeah.
Santa was the best part.
Yeah, he was.
Oh my God, we had a guy up front look like Santa. Did Santa in the malls? Not one of those weird diddly Santas. I mean, like a good Santa. And like we had people coming in, and they're like, "Well, we don't know if we believe or not." I was like, "Okay, well, you may pick the wrong room. Let's dive into that and why you know, and like, do you believe in Santa? He's right there. I mean, you know, if you believe in 8 tiny reindeer, you can believe in a large Sasquatch trying to eat one of them."
Very true.
And you really did lead the charge on that. I'm excited about what we're going to do again this year. More of us in attendance. Small Town Monster Fest was huge. And, of course, we're going to be at OBC here in just a couple weeks, those of us that can make it. That's got a hell of a lineup on it this year as well. I have a little nifty graphic for that right there. Look at those three handsome men.
Oh, look at that. What's the OBC? Is that odor body control?
It is.
Okay. Apropos. Okay.
Considering we're talking about the Ohio Bigfoot Conference, right? Mm-hmm. We got Matt Pruitt, Dr. Jeff Meldrum, Doug Hychick, Darby Orkut, Cliff Berrickman, and Adam Davies as the conference MC. Mm. Need to get Darby on the show and Matt Pruitt. I know we're working on Matt there, our good friend.
Right.
And cohort Matt Arner is working on that one in the background, but we had Doug on the show. Actually, I think it was one of our best episodes we've done in the last 100.
Right.
And of course, let's go around the room. I'll start with Matt. Who's been your favorite guest in the last 100 episodes? I know you haven't been with us for the full 100.
Yeah.
But you've been an avid listener for a while. Who was your favorite? We'll go around Baker, Vance, Henry, and then me.
I'll tell you, that's a tough one because Doug show was incredible. But I'll tell you, you know who might have inched up a little bit more, only because he inspired us, was Shane Corson from the Olympic Project.
Oh, thanks for taking my thunder.
Oh, I'm sorry. Seriously, like, you know, between those two, just being involved, you know, being part of the show. It was an honor, especially with Doug. I mean, he was incredible with what he was talking about, giving us some insight into what they were doing. But then, like I said, once we got discussing with Shane Corson about the nests, about the Olympic Project, about what they're finding out on the West Coast versus what we could be looking at here on the East Coast, it was really an amazing, amazing discussion. So I love Doug to death, but I'm going to have to give it to Shane for my favorite guest.
So. True up.
Baker, go ahead. Who was your favorite?
There's so many to choose from, and I always forget their names, which makes me feel sad. I was partial to, I think the last Squatch guys were on was on and was telling us some of the stuff, some of the stories from that. I always like the guests that take the time, like have like the best rapport. Like the one we had last week that was talking to us about the week before, where he was talking to us about the variety of things and like how he was doing investigations and how different things.
Chester Moore.
Yeah, Chester Moore. Yep. Mm-hmm. I liked him because he had a story, he had answers, he had really put the time in. If you had a random question, he knew it. Because I like those kind, because like when we go to OBC, a lot of times it's nice to hear the speakers, but when you've heard it for a few years, it's the same speech, but it's still good. Don't get me wrong, it's worth your money. Keep going. Especially if you can see Meldrum. He's worth every dollar. Mm-hmm. Even more. Okay. But like we actually had better conversations at the bar an hour after the thing closed down. We were talking about tree structures and don't be crazy, you know, and a variety of other things. And like those conversations, it was just like a big round table. But that's the way I like our guests, is when they have like a, you know, they're just a, you know, there's just a launching point.
Mm-hmm.
Fair enough. Vance, go ahead.
Like Matt said, Sean was amazing. He truly was amazing. But the one who was most eloquent in everything he had to say and was so descriptive in all the evidence and answering our questions was Eli Watson. Absolutely fantastic. I truly, really enjoyed having the conversation with Eli, because he got down deep into the rabbit hole and didn't go so far down into the rabbit hole where he could pull out a lot of sense for all of us to make an understanding of what it was that he was saying. And I greatly appreciated that show so much, because he's very eloquent in how he presented his point of view and the evidence in which he had to share with all of us.
Yeah, very good. Henry, go ahead.
Well, I initially, before we came on the air, I'd said that Cliff was my favorite guest, but I also like Doug Hijack, and I also like Shane Corson, and I did like Chester Moore. And as Matt said, it's hard to pick. It really is.
Right.
We had so many great guests, and they've shared so many different viewpoints and perspectives, which I really appreciate also. And they're not all the same, which is also good.
Mm-hmm. Right. I think, gentlemen, if I had to pick my favorite, it was David Wilbanks from Oklahoma. Mm-hmm. And you have to understand the story behind David Wilbanks, and Henry knows, like, I had such a desire to get him on Sasquatch Experience years ago when we were doing the first run, and we couldn't find him anywhere on social media. And so a couple years ago or a year ago, I started asking around if anybody, hey, has anybody heard of David Wilbanks? And here he's had a YouTube channel for a while.
Right.
And he's been doing his own stuff. So I was able to get in touch with him and get him on the show. It was just funny because, you know, he's somebody I always wanted to talk to. You got to remember, Bigfootville was the document. You have to, folks, you have to go way back into your time machines and go to the early 2000s and realize that there was not a lot to consume in terms of Bigfoot media like today. There was a couple Unsolved Mysteries episodes. There were a couple documentaries. There just wasn't what there was today. And thankfully, you know, with Small Town Monsters and Stacy Brown and Outcast Paranormal and a bunch of these other outlets, the Travel Channel, Discovery, there's a lot more being put out there that's bringing people into this field. And it's encouraging to see the interest. And rather it's a passing, fleeting interest or what have you, it's great to see a seriousness addressed to the topic. It's not tongue-in-cheek and kind of pop cultural and ha-ha, you know, let's make fun of the Bigfoot nerds. People are starting to find their own inner Bigfoot nerd, and it's really cool to be a part of it.
And I think it sticks with you, even if it fades away from the top priority of your interests. Right. It's still, you know, it's still deep within you, and you'll always, anytime you hear that term, Sasquatch or Bigfoot or Yeti, you're going to take an interest in it. And, you know, once you instill that into somebody, I think that brings more people into the community.
Yeah, agreed. And we do want that diversity of thought and experience into the Bigfoot community. We do, because we've been kind of insular over the, you know, the intro to these years that I don't want to say it was a members only club, but it was hard to get into and become established in this field. Now, because of social media and what have you, anybody can really do it, but it doesn't mean you can do it well, nor does it mean you should do it. Mm-hmm. For as much good content as there is out there, there's also an asshole with a camera and a web page, and you know, we've made it easy to share information. Doesn't mean the information that's being shared is worth its weight in salt.
Right.
At least here, we try to do the vetting for you to let you know if it is good information. And there is a difference. And I don't feel bad about that. It's not an editorial thing. It's that we have a responsibility as good journalists, a journalistic responsibility, to make sure we're providing you with something credible, rational, and, you know, still maybe just a little hint of sensational. But it still, to us, has to meet our criteria for what we want to put out for a witness. And look, we've had shows that have explored the paranormal aspect of Bigfoot, but I don't think any of us would put our stamp and say, hey, you know what, this is how it is.
No, but you brought up a really good point, because I think we do this on the show also on Sasquatch Experience, that we kind of blossom a little bit more. I won't say embellish, but we do try to blossom a little bit more than what the actual story is, so that the listener gets sucked in a little bit, so to say, more into the topic, so that they can do their own research. And we don't blow anything out of proportion but we definitely want to highlight the particular stories or events that have happened from witnesses, and we enunciate on that to try to make it a little bit more interesting so that a listener will go, well, that's pretty cool. Let's dive into this a little bit more. Even if it's one person that does that out of 10,000, at least we got one person into that to say, I'm really interested in this, because there's something behind all of this that's going on right now.
And, you know, we're not afraid to share different perspective on the topic either. And I think that's been a huge benefit. But I think one of the other things that makes us different than most is we get out there and still do the investigating. Mm-hmm. And Matt and I have really made it a purpose to share that. And granted, we put it on our Patreon, which you could become a member for as little as $2 a month, you know, with our Montour Road expeditions and outings. We've been putting a lot of effort into that. We had Alex Petikoff and Brian and Luca and Mike Lucci out there with us a couple weeks ago now, where we've spent some decent time out in those woods, James Baker, and, you know, bringing more folks into the research that we're doing. And I the one thing I'm proud of the most in the research that Matt and I do is that it's not embellished. You know, we're taking you out and giving you the experience as it's happening. We're not trying to influence. We go out and we call, and what happens, happens. The last time we were out, we had a whole lot of nothing, but that was what was disturbing to us the most, is because we had a lot of nothing of everything. There was an absence of everything, which was very alluring to us. Pardon me. And was hard to explain. But we give it to you real, and that's, you know, we're going to create a lot more content for you folks with that. Yep. Matt and I have a lot in the works with the actual research, boots on the ground, that we're doing, and we want you to enjoy it and become a part of that through our little exposés, and we'll be doing a little bit more on the podcast with it.
Which is very true, because out of every 100 times you go out to do any kind of exploration or research, maybe one time out of 100, you may come up with something, but the majority of the time, you're at a big fat goose egg. You've got zero. And that's good.
Well, we've had that discussion 100 times, how many times do you watch these channels? And I understand that they're trying to catch ratings, but they're fishing shows. You don't see the 12 hours sat there. Thing. You see the 30 minutes when it's real and whatever, why is there six scientists and one blonde girl with a tight shirt? You know why.
Right,
Henry, it's about the jiggling. We know why. But at least they're upfront about it. They're not upfront about it, but you watch a lot of shows, and you watch this show, and you listen to some of the things and some of the random things that I do at conferences and stuff, but it's genuine. And I think that's what keeps people in intrigued. But the thing is like, you watch a lot of these other shows and like $1 million Bigfoot evidence. Well, how is it every 30 minutes within a 45 minute every day, you have enough evidence to prove Bigfoot exists? No, you don't. Okay. Mm-hmm. No, you don't.
You meant the 10 million Bigfoot bounty.
It ain't all Primal Rage out there,
I would hope not.
Yep.
If you get a chance to watch that movie, please do. It's worth it.
Yeah.
But it's not a friendly children's movie. Okay.
No. And I agree.
The high point comedy of that is, you really can't give your opinion when your girlfriend's just wearing a shirt.
Yeah.
Well, listen, you can, but you're going to be getting something else from a horny Bigfoot.
She got some woodlands.
Yeah.
Another congrats, guys. 100, Uncle Zen.
Thank you, Zen.
Very much.
Yep. Yeah. Thank you, Zen.
We're proud of that number. Thanks, 100. Zen. Most of us don't get to make it. But do we have a watch along with Primal Rage recorded, or do we have one coming up?
I thought we had one, but I'm not sure that it was.
We have one with exists.
Yes.
Is it exists? We it need exists. To do Primal Rage.
We yeah. do need to do
Primal Rage. The problem with Primal Rage is I've seen it so many times that I'm like that guy that's at the theater going, wait, it's going to happen. Wait, this is going to happen. Okay.
Oh, and you're throwing stuff at the screen?
Yeah.
Okay.
No. Everybody in that movie deserved pretty much what they got because they that's were true. Stupid enough to do it.
Folks, if you haven't watched a watch along with us on these movies, I promise you that in itself is worth the $2 a month for the
hey, we got one coming up Saturday, don't we?
We do the recording for the Untold Sasquatch from I think it was 2002 with Lance Henriksen.
Mm-hmm.
Oh my god,
the biotech
Pumpkinhead
company who goes Pumpkinhead. To find the. His daughter's missing plane, and you find out he's right. not really trying to find the plane for his daughter, but the right. piece of technology that's on it. It's a great movie. It's not bad in concept. Mm-hmm. Execution's meh, but you're going to enjoy watching
it. Lance Henriksen.
Right. That's okay. Yeah, so join us on Saturday, and you'll have a little bit of fun outside of the Sasquatch experience, even though it's Sasquatch experience.
That's right. Patreon.com/Sasquatch experience pays you $2. We'll have a good time. Yeah. Anyhow, enough of that shameless plugging for
that's Primal Rage.
And there it is.
I wouldn't say
we get
shameless.
Him wound up. There's nothing I can do once we get him wound up, just for the record. He's on.
Yeah, I wouldn't say
on his own. Do you guys, before we go into break, I guess a question I have for you: with the next 100 episodes, we're starting a plan. Who do you want to talk to next?
Laura
folks
Coleman.
In the letter, or folks in the chat, you can go ahead and put it in the chat. Who you want us to talk to? Who do you want us to interview next? What topics do you want us to discuss?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Lauren Coleman, that's a good one, Baker.
And his right. new museum.
Yeah.
Yep.
One of my top favorite books on Bigfoot.
His new museum has been getting wailed on within the last couple of weeks from severe snowstorms.
Yeah,
I'm like, survive. How is he going to make it through with he'll 7 feet of snow? I know he will. I know. I get it. I totally get it. But yeah.
One topic we are going to get into is The Sensual Sasquatch, a book I got here from Randall.
Is it wrong?
Is it from Randy?
If loving you is wrong, I don't want to be wrong.
Is it Randall or is it Randy?
It's Randy. Yeah,
Randy.
Yeah.
Is it Randy?
So the book is really, I know it sounds kind of risque.
It is.
It is about, Randy. It is risky. It's about Sasquatch breeding habits and observed yes. Sasquatch sexual encounters. So
is it wrong for a 6-inch haired man to take your daughter age. Into the woods? Why? Yes, I think not.
It is. And
it's wrong.
Furthermore, I think in all seriousness, it's a topic that we can't be prudes about.
Right.
These things breed. And this book is all about observations of Bigfoot breeding encounters. So we're going to talk about it.
Sasquatch experience porn.
No, it's not pornographic. It's a perfectly natural, normal.
Sasquatch tube.
Folks, as you can see, this is what I deal with behind the scenes.
We asked the question if it's a regular or is it like a red rocket?
Now listen,
yeah.
Henry had the Playmate video, right? From the Redwoods video.
Yeah.
That was a question. It had that kind of tensile penis thing that was flopping around there.
Yeah.
And that was one of the questions that was leading to the validity of the video. And folks, I challenge
very
you to go
true.
Find it. It's the
very
Playmate
true.
Video. It was taken on a Playboy shoot in an RV, and this thing walks in front of the RV, and its appendage is flicking around and doing its thing.
Randy, baby. But you know what? To be completely honest with you, I've had that thought of, what if there is a woman solo in a remote area
is there that Randy baby type of mood when there's a human woman?
Matt, can I share one of your largest fears about call blasting?
Sure, absolutely. Go right ahead.
One of Matt's largest fears about call blasting is we don't know what the hell the sounds mean.
Correct.
Yeah. One day we're worried that we're going to get charged by a massive horny Bigfoot.
And if you ever seen me in real life, I'm about the size of Patty. So, yeah. You know, if I'm up there doing this Ohio owl and saying, hey, take me. And this 7-foot creature sees me down at the bottom of the hollow, you know,
man, true.
In the Ohio house. Guess what? You know,
Matt, I apologize early if it happens while me and Forker are there, because we're going to video it and we're going to make you keep the sample.
And it'll be titled Matt Fudge Packer Arner. Aww. And that'll be the title of the video.
Faster than you guys know.
I don't know, Matt. Have you ever seen me chase a pizza?
No. Look, when it comes down to losing my virginity to Sasquatch, I'm tripping your ass. Okay.
And this 100th episode has spiraled out of control.
Yes,
but when we come back, hopefully we have some people still watching. Though the worse this gets, the more viewers climb. I don't get it. Anyhow, we got some news. Catch us back on the flip side, folks. We'll be back in 7 minutes, 25 seconds.
News team! Assemble!
I get pulled in by Discovery. They own me, dude. You know, they get me with this Loch Ness every time. Loch Ness, searching for Loch Ness again. And I know I'm going to be disappointed at the end of the show. Every show ends the same way. We didn't find anything. All right.
Ah, yes. I think the great phrase takeaway from that statement is being sucked in. I'll let your imaginations run wild with that. Welcome. This is the Bigfoot Bullhorn right here on the Sasquatch Experience. And as my due diligence is appointed to me from Sean Forker, do news stories and information. So I did come across a BFRO report from exactly 1 month ago on March 15th. The witness is quoted as saying, "My wife and I saw something walking into the tree line near our home in Winnsboro, Texas. It was enormous. At first, I thought it was a cow or a horse until I noticed it was taller and only on two legs. I only saw its back, but it had to be 4 feet wide at the shoulders. It was covered in a reddish-brown hair and was around 6 inches long. The hair, that is. We should have pulled over to look back, but it walked into the pasture, and my wife had no interest in that." Now, there was a follow-up interview by the BFRO by none other than Matt Moneymaker, who said, "I spoke with the witnesses at length by phone, and both he and his wife are in their 40s. Both are very credible. They were heading north on Farm Route 312, driving anywhere between 55 and 60 miles an hour in a Ford Explorer, and their vehicle was the only vehicle on the road when the sighting occurred. Both saw a tall Sasquatch clearly in the headlights. The figure was on the left side of the road, 10 feet from the road's edge, and it was between the road and tree line, but closer to the trees. Boy, if that's not confusing. It came into their view at about 70 feet away, and as they got closer and passed it, they both looked at each other and said, 'What the hell was that?'" Pretty cool report, if you ask me. I put that in a typical roadside crossing sighting, even though I probably already crossed the road. But who knows? Maybe it was late for an appointment or for school. You know, that'd be kind of a cool school mascot, a Sasquatch. Wait, what's this?
A mythical creature marching through your neighborhood in St. Johns County? Well, not quite, but Sasquatch is the thing of legend for one St. Johns County community, with a new school even donning the name for its new mascot. Action News Jax Logan McDonald spoke to a parent today who says they believe.
The Sasquatch may be a thing of legend, but if you ask anyone in St. Johns County's Beacon Lake community, the legend of the Sasquatch very much is real, alive, and well.
Yeah, we've heard a couple things about that too, so, you know, I mean, I'm pretty sure I hope I don't see the real Sasquatch.
In Beacon Lake, the legend is a little bit two-dimensional, though. There's been a cardboard cutout of the mythical creature in the woods of the development for over 4 years. And now, not without extensive criticism online, it'll be the official mascot of Lakeside Academy, a K-8 school set to open in fall of this year.
I mean, I think it's cool. When we first found out about it, everybody kind of always picks a traditional animal, or, you know, you never really hear about the Sasquatch idea.
And while some may question the eccentric name for the new school's mascot, Dave Pivnik says, why the fuss, and is embracing the beast ahead of his daughter attending Lakeside Academy later this fall.
You know, my daughter was the one who first noticed the cutout of the Sasquatch in the woods, and then we all saw it and thought it was pretty cool, and then when we found out about, you know, the mascot, we thought it, you know, was a perfect fit.
As Pivnik would say, long live the Sasquatch. The local coverage you can count on, reporting from St. Johns County, Logan McDonald, Action News Jax.
You know, my biggest takeaway from that report is the fact that it was a cardboard cutout that had been there for 4 years. What kind of cardboard are you people using that can withstand wind and rain and snow and sun above? Whatever. It's cardboard. When we come back, we're going to keep reminding you of a special event coming up. Stick around.
You're listening to the Bigfoot Bullhorn right here on the Sasquatch Experience.
Hello. I'm Vance Nesbitt, and you may know me from the hit show Sasquatch Experience. Now introducing a new fan-based store of original Sasquatch Experience merchandise, Squatch Pro Shop, offering quality-made and designed shirts from the classic prints to current prints. And now we're also offering the genuine Yeti Company Rambler Travel Mug with the custom-made Sasquatch Experience logo. Stop by now and buy one shirt for the price of two and receive the second shirt for absolutely free. Visit SasquatchExperience.com and go to Squatch Pro Shop. Thank you. Yeah, the up-and-coming happy event of the annual Ohio Bigfoot Conference, which is taking place on Star Wars Day, Saturday, May 4th of this year at Salt Fork Lodge and Conference Center at the Salt Fork State Park in Cambridge, Ohio. We would love to see all of you there. Baker and Sean will be signing autographs. The only reason why I'm going is to do my Adam Davies impersonation.
Oh my God, who the hell cares?
Thanks again for listening to this edition of the Bigfoot Bullhorn right here on the Sasquatch Experience. And
until we meet again,
keep your toes in the mud.
Thanks, Vance. Good Bigfoot Bullhorn segment right there. And yes, I did make him get back to the news. I thought there was a little news. Like how he throws me under the bus for that one.
I did.
Good job, buddy. Well,
no. We don't just entertain, we educate.
Yes.
Education is important. It's part of our mission of what we do here.
Edumacation.
Folks, if you're just tuning in, I'm Sean the Fork Chop Forker. He's Matt Arner, James Baker, Vance Nesbitt, and Henry May, my longest-running co-host in the history of Bigfoot professional broadcasting. Wow. I said that in one breath. It got a little faint.
Wow. Bigfoot, yeah, you were winded by
broadcasting. That. Look at me. I get winded easy these days. Not hard, for Christ's sakes. Anyhow, shut up, James. You're going to get, I'm about ready to hit his mute button tonight. Someone got him turned on before we got on the show.
Cialis, the little blue pill. Yeah.
Anyhow, that's not what I meant by turned on. Now that concept's frightening me. Anyhow, so before we went on the air, I asked you some guests you guys wanted to have on the show, and this is where I want to talk. Where do we want to go from here? Who do we want on? I know we're trying to get Matt Pruitt. We want to get him locked down. There's some great people, though, we want to talk to. So let us have it, folks. Who do you want to hear? And, guys, this is for you.
Wow. Boy.
And you can vote for yourself. If you have a story to tell us, please feel free to contact us and tell us that story. And if you feel like you could tell other people in this kind of format, or we could try to do one of them FBI deals where we all squiggle you up and stuff, and you'll be like, my name is Bob.
Right.
Does that ever really work, though? Does that ever really
Victims work? Protection or whatever?
Right. Not really. No.
Of course, you can always report your sighting or encounter at info@sasquatchexperience.com. Thanks for that opportunity to throw that in there, Bake. Appreciate
that. That was my goal.
One person I'd like to see, I'm going to have to reach out to him, is Tate Hieronymus.
Yeah.
He has that search for Bobby. Yeah. He's been putting out some good stuff. He really good guy. And I think he would be an excellent guest on the show. So,
all right. Yeah. We also have to get Jeremiah on from Bigfoot Society.
Tate jokingly claims he's related to Bob Hieronymus.
I know it's
their last names are spelled different, though. That's the only thing.
Yes.
Right.
Yeah, but the average person can't even pronounce Hieronymus. So
I know. Yeah.
Anonymous. Wait, child, how do you spell that? Yeah, no, I totally get it.
So an Ohio Bigfoot moment. So we're watching, this is when I think the Bigfoot movie came out. And we're standing over there, and I'm standing with like three other guys. I think Forker's there too. And they're like, boy, this movie's cheap. They only had that one suit. And I'm like, well, you know, Gimlin only needed that one suit.
Right.
Oh my God. Like in that moment, I thought for sure I was going to be lynched and run out on a rail.
Yeah. Yeah. Thanks, Gwen, for that 100th.
Yeah, thank you, Gwen. Congrats.
Mm-hmm. Now, that was a moment. If there's some asshole puckering moments I've ever been involved with James Baker by things he said, that was one of them. There's another comment in West Virginia that was made with a person of color and a gun that... it wasn't.
We'll never forget that. Yeah. We'll never forget that.
Just so I don't come off as a horrible person in another light. Let's do this.
It's a Ghostbusters thing.
So
yeah,
we're watching. So this gentleman comes up. You remember the movie Jeepers Creepers, The Creeper? And the guy next to him has got a full on military. He's got like a military kind of looking thing on. He's got a rifle. And he walks up to me and he goes, I'm going to just kill myself. Doesn't it look real? I'm like, good enough to get a black man killed.
We were
in Virginia, and I was drinking cold brew.
I witnessed a lot of
moments of our trips to West Virginia that we've taken on behalf of the show over the years. Let's see. James Baker and the, how do you like your eggs, to the lady at the front desk.
She was
fertilized.
She was definitely a two-pack-a-dayer.
Oh, my God. What time's the morning breakfast?
Yeah, I thought we were. No, that wasn't it.
You guys
we have completely derailed.
You guys
we're like East Palestine, Ohio right now. Right. Oh, man, we have so derailed.
It's going to get worse in Ohio because Baker hasn't been out of the house a lot. So, like, folks, if you
are. I work from home now.
He bites, so don't get within 5 feet. He's not a hugger, and he does have teeth. Yes, so.
I do not like
Yeah, me. But you can ask for an autograph. So when you see us at the Ohio Bigfoot Conference, please feel free to come up and chit-chat with us. And if you have anything you want to share in your personal experience, we would love to hear it. And if you want it shared, that's fine. If you don't, we respect that.
Listen, we were at the Penn Ohio conference and we had a gentleman that was trying to share his experience with us. And then we had another gentleman who was more of an expert than we were.
He knew everything.
And it's, you know, if you do, folks, just etiquette, if you see somebody sharing their story, come back and see us. You don't have to hang around. You don't have to, you know, interject. Give that person their time and we'll give you your time. It just makes it awkward for the person who may be trying to share a story with us that may want it to be confidential. And I don't want to have to be the asshole that looks at you and say, hey, how you doing? Can we help you with anything? Oh, we'll be with you in just a few minutes. You know, just respect. Like we do. People that do want to share their stories with us may not want to do it in a public forum, but we are here for them. So have some good form, chaps. Be upstanding. We're going to have a lot of friends with us in Ohio, too. I know Gwen and Mike Persona are going to be there. Bill on the Hill Rigby is going to be there. We're a lot of friends of the Sasquatch Experience will be in attendance. And this, we've been to quite a few OBCs, have we not, Henry?
Indeed, we have. I wish I was going this year.
We wish you were too.
It's a stellar lineup. Yeah.
It's a good lineup. It's a great lineup. And we are a sponsor of the Ohio Bigfoot Conference as well. So we got two big conferences out there. And again, this is why, you know, you've heard me say this 42 times tonight. Share who you want to hear. Share who you'd like to see be interviewed. One, my mind reading skills have not gotten any better as I've gotten older. Though, like fine wine, I may be aging well. My brain is not. And also, like, the same with the folks that are putting together these conferences. You know, if you want to hear somebody, let the conference organizers know so they can get somebody different.
True.
You know,
I want to hear from the spokespeople of WD-40 to talk to Baker and see if we can't get that chair a little bit quieter.
So speaking of that and sponsorships, I'm just going to bring a little tidbit out about our last expedition that we were out at. Sean and I doused ourselves in Sawyer's.
Yep.
And the other guys did not. And they were pulling ticks off of them left and right. Sean and I were tick free. So thumbs up to Sawyer's.
In fact, I'm going to get ready to put I'll put that link in the chat. It's important that folks see this, and hopefully it does post as a link.
I'm partial to Deep Woods Off.
No, I tell you, man.
No.
Nope. I've completely screwed up
a watch of mine. I had a really nice watch, and I put the DEET on, and it melted all the plastic on my watch.
Yeah,
so.
it eats synthetics like you wouldn't believe.
Here's something else that's important. If you are going to treat your fabric, do not go around cats.
Mm-hmm.
Cats will die around the permethrin.
Right.
So spray it on. And Matt is not kidding. We had no ticks on us whatsoever. Yep. Everybody else was getting inundated. I also didn't break out or get any kind of weird skin rashes from it because we applied it while wearing our clothes.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's good.
It is a good product. And of course, your actual mileage may vary when wearing it. But again, be mindful around animals, like not so much dogs. It's about how the liver enzymes don't break down the permethrin in cats.
Yep.
So don't wear it if you're going to be around cats.
Permethrin is kind of a dangerous product.
Right.
But if you're out in the Pacific Northwest and you have a mountain lion behind you,
yeah,
I would spray it with Sawyer's. Yeah. It'll sit there and go, So
that's a good point, Matt.
Yeah.
Oh, I like
take that mountain cat.
Take your permethrin. Here's my laser pointer. Go get that.
Yeah.
And it does. You don't have to dose on it every time, though. You probably should. It lasts what 6 to 10 washes, depending.
Six washes.
Washes. Yeah.
Yep.
Wow.
So that's product. That's my plug for a good product along with
WD-40. We were walking through high grass and tick infested woods. We didn't have any, but other members of our party did. So
this
is the education part. When you have disease that are getting so spread by ticks right now, and nobody in our group is fond of ticks. Let me tell you, things like the alpha gall disorder you get. The Rocky Mountain spotted fever, Lyme disease, all spreadable by ticks. And if you
damn little rash,
if you can prevent it, go out of your way and get it. And it's not the most expensive product on the market either.
Still got
it does well.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Just think we did an infomercial on Sawyer's.
Yes.
Really important.
How about it?
It kind of goes back to that show we talked about over the Christmas time where we were talking about the gear. Mm-hmm. You know, we have another episode coming up with you, me, and Larry Baxter. That's a special project called Squatcher Safety.
Yep.
It's really safety and education is just as important to us as the information factor because we don't want you going out there and getting hurt.
Mm-hmm.
No one should be killed over a hobby.
I don't know about you guys, but I prefer to be as injury-free as possible. And I'm always learning something when I go out with Matt or the guys. And it's worth tuning in. And so when we get that episode up, we'll post that. That's a special episode we got coming the listener's way.
Fabulous.
It is fabulous. What else? Oh, some other guests I'd like to hear. I'd like to get... You know, I'd like to get some of the newer up and coming Bigfooters on the program, like Nash Hoover and some other folks that have kind of been jumping onto the radar and maybe reaching back and pulling in some of the other researchers that have willingly or unwillingly fallen into obscurity. You know, some folks just disappear because they want to. Mm-hmm. You know, we saw Billy Willard come back over at Sasquatch Watch Radio. It's great to have Billy back out into the fold again, but I'd like to get Billy on and talk to us here.
And it was a great show that you did with him, by the way.
Right. Well, you know, a lot of people don't know is that the day his sons had their sighting, they called me immediately as it was happening.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I was on the phone with them in real time as they were having their sighting encounter. A remarkable thing. And... that seems like it's been almost two decades ago, and it probably has, but very impactful moment. So Billy and I have kind of had
a bro moment.
Right.
Pretty much.
And Billy and I have been out in the field together. We've had rocks thrown at us. We've had a lot of situations. We had eyes shine. Thanks, Baker. But we, again, you know, we can talk about all the things that we have had happen, but the things that you got to take into consideration, this is a 28-year career. You know, I have had a handful of things happen in 28 years I've been doing this.
Mm-hmm.
So if somebody's telling you they've had something happen every time they go out in the woods, they're either the luckiest son of a bitch I ever knew, so get them for some lottery numbers.
Yeah, I ain't buying
it. Or it's just not as it appears to be.
Right.
Well,
and that's your discernment, I guess. Go ahead, Jay.
And that's one of the common things that I always rant about is the fact is that you can't say you've seen it 25 times and have no evidence.
Mm-hmm.
You can't.
Right.
I'm sorry. If you habitually know that it shows up on Tuesday after 5, you could rig up a camera because by then it trusts you enough you could probably capture it with a net. Mm-hmm. You know, like there's just so much. There's so much that's just like. That's like we kind of had that discussion when we were at Rigby's event was like the guy come up and he's like, oh, yeah, I've seen it like 40 times and this and there's different ones and this. And he's like, and I've gone across the state and run into other ones. I'm like, nobody's that much of a magnitude for Bigfoot. You know, like you should be tested in the lab because you either smell funny or there's something or whatever. But there's no person. I mean, we talk a lot about sightings and what we believe. And even like you were mentioned the book about how they may propagate, you know, do they have a red rocket? Do they not? You know, but the thing is at the end of the day, 90% of what we do, 90% of what we do is let's guess and try not to make up something so unoriginal. You know, and that we try to use science at the same time, but until somebody hits it with their car. And we got a body we could drag out that isn't in a cooler in Georgia. We're guessing. And Henry knows that one.
Henry, what do you think of Baker's assessment? Now, Henry, keep in mind, you've went and investigated a habituator situation.
I did. It was the Janice Carter situation. And I got to say, I did not come away with too much evidence.
Yeah.
We had one too.
There.
Yeah. We had one too where it came down every night into down to the lady's kitchen window. But the night that me and Les were out there, he didn't happen to come in. So for whatever reason, but he was there every single night other than that.
Well, and again, there's always the potentiality that we're new.
Yes.
And we scare it off. However, I don't know. We could go into a whole nother hour on this.
Sure.
And we do want to mindful of our viewers' time. Sure. But habituation is dangerous because I do think there are folks out there who experience repeat visitations. However, I do not think that the people that are experiencing the repeat visitations are any remotely in control of the situation. As some people claim to be when they are habituating. Oh, I've held one or I've touched it. And, I know exactly how to attract them. I leave them there. Like, okay, I'm not buying it because you've got nothing to show for it.
Right.
I think the problem is with the habituation isn't as much that's happening. So, for instance, on my land, I see deer every time. Constantly. They might not be the same deer, but I see them and now they're getting used to me and they're getting bolder. But here's the thing is I'm not touching the deer. I'm not doing anything. That deer is completely in charge of what's going on, how far they get close, whatever. These people are like, I make a wood knock and they're always coming up for pie, and I know how many children I have because the children come near me. That's where the story gets longer. Like if you could live in a place where says per se that a unknown creature has gone because maybe you're in their travel area. But the fact is though, is when you start adding to the story about how you guys hang out and you gotta, they've got a special name for you and they give you gifts and whatever, as the more layers you add to that pile of crap, the worse, the less we believe it's possible. Just tell us, hey,
right.
It goes through my backyard maybe once a month. I think it's on its way to Boston. I don't know. Maybe it's a Bruins fan. Who knows? Or it's on its way down south because it's getting cold. I see it during the winter. That is reasonable. But then they start adding. Like the worst thing that ever happened to me on a sighting report was we went to this guy brought us over to a park and he showed us all these pictures and said, this is this. And every circle he had in the picture was one more thing. Like if he could have just picked one thing to circle in the picture,
right,
it would have been fine. And then when I asked for the original picture, it's his grandmother's bay window.
Yeah.
But the fact is everybody lost interest when it was like, it's not just Sasquatch. In this picture, there's a Sasquatch in the corner. There's an alien. Then there's a ghost cat.
What a gray. And,
you lost me at more than one item. They aren't all Jubilee and out in your grandma's yard.
Jubilee. Folks, if you want one more book suggestion tonight, as we talk like a little books. Bit about habituation, The Locals by Tom Powell here is a phenomenal book. And Henry, we should get Tom on the show. Never had him on Sasquatch Experience. This is one of my top five favorite books. There's so much that goes into that. It's not just your typical Bigfoot book. It really goes into some of the more controversial topics, even more controversial at the time when the book was written in the 2000s. This is a really good fresh copy because I had to buy a new one. I also have it digital, and somebody out there has my original copy of this book. So,
I stole it.
Somebody borrowed it and didn't give it back, like one of my four copies of Sasquatch, The Apes Among Us, which is still my favorite book of all time. But The Locals, get yourself a copy of that book, read it. Because actually, I think that book may be the beginning of some of the things we start getting into in depth in the next few months over Sasquatch Experience. And a few folks, listeners, you find yourself involved in the topic a little bit more and engaged with what we're talking about, the more interactive you are and the more fun we have. And we like to have fun here at the Sasquatch Experience. Gentlemen, any final thoughts before we wrap it for the night?
Well, it's 100 episode and wow, really? I'm trying to wrap my mind around the fact of how time flies.
but it also puts into retrospect the amount of time that goes by and we continue doing this research, and we do get a little bit more nuggets here and there, but boy, oh boy, I can't believe that when I was asked, hey, would you be willing to be part of the Sasquatch experience? And it's 100 episodes later. Holy cow. Wow. That went by fast.
It did. It's been a long 100 episodes, but guess what? We've got more. Some of you might like that. Some of you may not, but alas, here we are.
Yeah.
Henry, final thoughts for anybody?
Well, I'm looking forward to the next 100.
No.
See what we awesome. Get the show.
We have next show will be probably before we go to OBC. Yeah, it'll be the OBC pre-show.
I think so. I think it's the Monday before we go to OBC. So
it should be the 29th.
Yep. Mm-hmm. So we're going to have some fun then. Anybody else? Matt, Baker, any final thoughts, parting words, or gifts?
Just looking forward to the next big celebration, Sal.
Me too. Me too. Baker? Sasquatch isn't like the neighbor at Home Improvement. Sasquatch isn't Wilson?
No. No, he is not. And as Henry
thank
puts
you,
it.
Carlene. Appreciate it.
Henry, my favorite quote from you is, think Bigfoot last when you're investigating.
Yeah, right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Think Bigfoot last. The t-shirt you can now buy from our Squatch Pro Show.
There it is. Right.
If anybody wants to get James a gift, that's what you want to get him. One, a hoodie with it on the back that says, in investigation, think Bigfoot last.
You know, I would love to see a hoodie or a t-shirt that said, oh my God, there was no train that came through Baker's backyard tonight.
It came through.
Yeah. Hey, that sounds like a dirty term, okay? There's no train coming. Now, maybe up the street, but.
I lose control. Henry, take us out with those parting words.
Y'all be good or be good.
I don't know.
Keep on squatching, folks. We'll see you next time.
And we've got the next one.
You've been listening to the Sasquatch Experience. Please rate and review where this podcast has been consumed. To share your experience, visit us on Facebook, our website, or email us info@sasquatchexperience.com. Keep on squatching.